Hello, my name is Rohani Backus, Chair for the Greenbelt East Advisory Coalition, Inc. GEAC holds monthly forums where representatives of communities discuss and achieve a united position on matters of interest to Greenbelt and Greenbelt East. We present these positions to the City of Greenbelt and other government entities, as well as to the Greenbelt East citizen as a whole. Each year, GEAC conducts a joint stakeholders meeting with members of City Council along with City Manager and other officials, in which we present questions from various areas of concern impacting residents, as well as sharing ideas and information. Some of the topics we discussed with Council that are important to us were budget, legislation, planning and transportation, emergency preparedness, crime, zoning, code enforcement, and economic development. We hope you will find this video helpful. Thank you.
Call to order. Okay, thank you guys. Thank you everyone. Welcome. Welcome, Greenbelt City Council, GEAC members, and homeowners. It's been a long winter. It feels like I haven't seen anyone in quite a while. Thank you guys for coming here today. Thank you for coming and welcome this afternoon to the bring GEAC concerns and issues to Council. GEAC developed the questions collectively, and they were sent to City Manager Mike McLaughlin on February the 20th. Several of our members will share the responsibility of asking or reading the asked questions, and I suppose City will answer them. I believe I got that correct.
Yeah.
Oh, good. And then after reading the questions, we'll wait for City response. After City response, then I'm going to ask around the room for any, if anybody have any questions, concern, or any feedback on the answers. So we can begin. Thank you, Mayor.
But before we begin, I just want to say that all of us on Council really look forward to this work session with the Greenbelt East Advisory Coalition, something that we do every year. And homeowners associations in Greenbelt, I like to say that Greenbelt is really a city of associations. And the homeowners associations are the glue that sort of hold everything together for us. So we're sorry that it snowed and we had to cancel the work session. I know the rest of the council, we took a vote and it wasn't supposed to this stuff, but it didn't. So all kidding aside, we do look forward to this occasion to sit and talk. And although you have questions and it's pretty formal responding, I want to make sure that it's an open dialogue. If the GEAC has other questions or if people that are here with us have questions, I'd like to have a nice open dialogue. So I do have to express some regrets. Councilman Conrad Hurley is under the weather. He's not feeling well. He's not going to be here with us tonight. But also, Councilman Ed Hughes will be with us. He's detained. He's actually having an annual meeting with his homeowners association. So I don't know if you, usually when we start these work sessions, we want to kind of go around able just to, even though we all know each other, still, it's nice to kind of go around and everybody can introduce for the people that maybe tuned in on television. So why don't we go ahead and do that? Why don't we start over here?
Oh, thank you. I'm Terry Benedict, and I am the Greenbrier representative for GEAC.
Mike McLaughlin, City Manager.
Emmett Jordan, City Council Mayor, and a resident of Greenbrier.
David Moran, Assistant City Manager.
Now, Judith Thompson, the Woods of Green representative and Secretary of GEAC.
I'm Austin Henry from Green Spring One.
I'm Rohani Backus, Chair of GEAC, as well as HOA Board Member of Green Spring Two, and a member of the Binding Community.
I'm Pat Boyd. I'm with Greenbelt Lake Village. I'm also a board member of Greenbelt Lake Village, and I'm an architect.
I'm Tom Brando. I'm from Greenbelt Lake Village. I'm also on the board there too.
Charlene McAdams, Greenwood Village board member, and I'm also the treasurer of GEAC.
Jay Davis, Mayor Pro Tem, a resident of
Greenbelt City Council.
Sophie Pope, Greenbelt City Council, and head of HOA over my development over at Bell Point.
And one question, Barry Oliver, homeowner in Greenspring 1.
He's my better half. I'm Barry Oliver over at Greenspring 1.
So, let's go ahead and get started.
Okay. Well, we've got the questions. Should we just dive right into the questions?
Sure.
Okay. Who's reading the first question? I believe I am. The subject one is the budget. And the first question that was opposed to the budget is, we anticipate budget cuts at all levels in the coming year. Please outline those which you expect will most impact our residents. How can GEAC assist the city to promote or defeat specific cuts and help to lessen their effect on our residents? Which areas can we expect to see a significant decrease?
Okay. We just got an update from the city manager just on Monday at the council meeting. We were talking, got the first glimpse at the city of the Greenbelt budget meeting. And as you probably know, we have a very transparent and very open process for approving the budget. The city manager talks with all of the department heads, puts together his budget. We actually have 10 work sessions and two public hearings on the Greenbelt budget. But as far as the idea of budget cuts at all levels and how they will actually impact Greenbelt, we're not so sure. You know, the city of Greenbelt has always been pretty conservative about the way that it manages resources. So as far as the condition of the city going forward, we are optimistic that there will be no cuts. In fact, this year's budget is actually looking perhaps cautiously a little bit better than the past few years. But to address your question directly, when you're asking about cuts at the federal level, cuts at the state level, and cuts at the county level. As you probably know, the county executive released his budget on the 13th of March, just last Friday. So we're still looking at that budget. From what I understand, there is a pretty ambitious proposal from the county executive about raising taxes in order to enhance revenue for the schools. So they have a similar process to Greenbelt, where the county executive consults with his department heads and formulates a budget that goes to county council. The county council actually approves that budget and makes modifications. So I'm really not sure what's going to happen with that budget. I'm sure that my colleagues from council have some thoughts, but with the proposal, he is actually proposing some tax increases and the possibility of furloughing some employees, county employees. Now, how that affects us, I'm not sure. Hopefully, those furloughs or layoffs would not be with the schools. If they were with the schools, that would have an impact on Greenbelt in a very direct way. But because we have our own police department, our own public works, our own recreational programs and social services, I think that, in all likelihood, Greenbelt would not be impacted that much. Well, on the federal level, one thing, budget cuts and funding, one thing that you probably notice is the condition of the Baltimore-Washington Parkway and some of the streets, Greenbelt Road, Kenilworth Road, those are state roads. And the Baltimore-Washington Parkway is actually run by the National Park Service. So they are outside of our realm of control. And frankly, the Baltimore-Washington Parkway, the ramps are in terrible condition. We've been complaining and trying to work with the National Park Service, who contracts the work out for several years. They prepared the west southbound ramp on the west side. But the ramps, Kenilworth Road, potholes, that's the most tangible thing that I see. Council, do you have thoughts?
In fact, tonight, CEO Kevin Maxwell is having a meeting with the Board of Ed to
playing the Board of Education budget, which is going to dovetail with County Executive Sharon Baker's proposal, because his proposal is a basically a 15 cent tax rate increase. And that money is supposed to go directly to education to make sure that the maintenance, the school construction, teacher salaries, whatever, is taken care of. He's basically, Richard Baker asked Ken Maxwell, what do you need to make this a number one school, a top-notch school? So Ken gave his whole list. And supposedly, this money, which is going to be this year and next year, there would be further increases, was supposed to take care of that. Now, the general atmosphere, feeling I seem to be receiving from a lot of people is, yes, we want money to go to education. Yes, we want good schools. But that we've heard this before, casino money or whatever. And we want to be sure that that money is going directly there and that it's going to be the most efficiently used. So there's a whole bunch of discussion. Delegate News from a different district put in a bill just yesterday, the day before, that basically will put a stop to 15 cent increase and basically says you have to deal with trim. Trim is supposed to keep some of these tax increases from going up so high, but County Executive Sharon Baker said that there's a loophole that he received from the state legislature that allows him to do this. So keep watching the news, keep watching the newspapers. The county council is going to get a hold of this, and they're going to be going through it too, so it should be quite interesting.
If you want me to talk a little bit about the city budget, perhaps the city manager, I have a handout for you. It's a budget process for us. Like I mentioned, we have 10 work sessions and 2 public hearings, and we just received the first glimpse of the budget, proposed budget from the city manager on Monday. And his projections for revenue were a little bit better than for the past few years. We've been at the same level pretty much, about $25 million in revenues. But the things that are changing, that, you know, we've got this 3-year property value assessment. And because we're coming up on that transition year, we're thinking that our property values are going to increase slightly. Also, we do have new construction out at the south core of the metro station. The townhouses have gone up. And in general, the value of the apartment developments in Greenbelt, not the single-family homes, not the condominiums, but the apartments, have actually appreciated. And that's part of a larger trend that you're seeing throughout Washington, D.C., where the apartment market is really hot. So those have actually improved our real property values. Mr. McLaughlin, do you want to say anything?
Be happy to. I think Mayor Jordan hit on the key points with it. As you said, this is the PowerPoint that was presented Monday evening. I call your attention to the third page, which I think really gets to what Mayor Jordan said. This top chart is the value of property in the city of Greenbelt. And that is real property that generates about 60% of the city's revenue through tax receipts. And if you look at fiscal year 14, it looks like that was the turning point. Where we stopped heading down, we've had over a 20% drop in assessed valuation since fiscal year 2009. And it looks like we're ticking up a little bit. As the mayor said, that was in the first year, primarily driven by value in apartments. Greenbelt apartments, by our survey, had over 90% occupancy, and a number of the apartment complexes, like Franklin Park, like University Square, like Park Crescent, the Red Bricks, if you will, in the Stark parts, have been reinvesting in their buildings. And so when they reinvest in their buildings, they can raise the rate. So high occupancy, good revenue generation was raising the value of the apartments. Fiscal year 15 was the second dot, if you will, on the upward trend. And now fiscal year 16, for me, that makes it a real trend. I think we're heading in the right direction, and then next fiscal year, as the mayor says, not this coming one, but one after that, there'll be new assessment numbers. And we did some analysis leading into the budget, and what we're finding is the sales price of homes in Greenbelt over the last 6 months is over 35% higher on average than the assessed value of those same properties. So we think that's a real positive trend for the community. In the comments or in the responses that you have, I just want to make note that these were written before the March 6th meeting and have not been updated, but question number two, as to, I guess, raised with what cuts might happen, I think there's some more good news that Mayor Jordan and Mayor Pro Tem Davis would be happy to expand on, but the big cut that we were fearing on the revenue side of highway user revenue appears to have dodged the one roadblock put in its way, and so what we thought might be a $200,000 revenue cut to the city doesn't look like it's going to happen. Mayor Jordan, Mayor Pro Tem Davis can go into that in more detail. I guess two other things, no tax rate increase. So since most assessments of existing property we expect are going to be flat for the coming fiscal year, that should mean for, on average, little to no tax increase for homeowners in Greenbelt. Let me leave it at that. I'd be happy to answer any questions now or after the meeting.
Yeah,
in your comments, you suggested that you anticipated cuts everywhere, but I think that the proposed budget doesn't have cuts like we had in previous years. And in fact, it does look to sort of work on some of our issues and our goals, including proposing 2.9 additional positions. And of course, organization like a city, what we do is we provide services, and that means people. So that's, I think, good news. And as the council delves into this more, I think we'll find out more about what's going on. But it's good news that there wasn't any, or it didn't need to be any cuts in the manager's proposed budget, and that it looks like there will be able to bring in some new people to help.
Great news. In regard to question number two, or just the uncertainty, we still aren't quite sure with the new administration at the state level, the governor, where, although the state legislature is in the middle of their session, actually just passed the bill, and both the House and Senate have passed their budget bill, we're still not exactly sure how things are going to work out, so we're cautious. Some of the big projects that have been important to Prince George's County, the hospital in Largo and the Purple Line. If you talk to people, if you talk to the county executive, the people in the county, they're very cautious. I have to tell you, Governor Hogan is pretty familiar with this area. He actually grew up over in Seabrook. So I think he may actually be more sensitive to our Greenbelt's needs, hopefully, than we might think. The highway user funds are something that we've been struggling with. The state had in the past allocated through a formula money to municipalities to maintain roads and infrastructure. And I guess going back about 4 or 5 years ago, that funding was cut. Mayor Pro Tem Davis could probably say something.
Yeah, every year, you've heard me say this every year, we would like to get back the full amount because basically this is based on the gas tax, but it is a formula. The municipalities are supposed to get a certain percentage. Well, when the budget kind of became bad, that formula was kind of put in the drawer, and we were given money, not that much. And we've been working with it, we've still been repairing the highways and the roads and the sidewalks, but a lot of it's coming out of your taxes, not the money that should come out. Governor Hogan at the Maryland Municipal League summer conference before the election promised the municipalities that he would put money back in the budget. And he did. He actually lived up to that promise and we were very happy. And it was part of his supplemental budget. And it would add money to, still wouldn't be the full amount, but still would be quite a big help. Unfortunately, everyone was kind of sailing along. Baltimore County and Howard County, which are one of two of the richest counties we have, decided that counties get money too, highway user funds. Well, they thought that they should get more. They don't have municipalities, so they should get the municipality share that all the other kids, and it's like, wait a second, this is all coming from one little pot, you're cutting everybody out. So that was introduced, but it was defeated. So that's gone. Another good thing was that I believe County Executive Sharon Baker and Governor Hogan and a couple of others got together, and they really pushed the funding for the interchange over by the metro station. That has to be finished. That's part of the FBI proposal, that has to be finished. And he's part of the state proposal, and it's still in there, it's still in the budget. So we'll keep our fingers crossed on that.
Okay, we'll put questions out on the floor, comments, suggestions, feedback, anyone from the floor, briefly, because we're on our time schedule.
Just one more thing. I understand at Delegate Washington's listening session last Saturday, there was some discussion about the casino money and the fact that it's dedicated to education, and the fact that that money, we haven't really realized that money yet. It's coming along. Will that impact, as you increase the rates and look at everything in order to fully fund the education program, then you have a new influx of money. What do you see happening there?
Well, I would hope that would be the case. I know that they actually put the casino, the dedicated funding for the casinos into place. That's only been in place for about a year.
Right.
So just in terms of funding being there, there's something in the Washington Post today that we're talking about, and maybe the Baltimore Sun, we're talking about the amount of revenue that's coming from the Horseshoe Casino in Baltimore is quite a bit less. I mean, they just built the place.
Right.
So hopefully those revenues will be a help. I'm not sure if it's going to be a panacea. And certainly the school's promise, I suppose, was made to the schools. It's going to take a little time.
Yeah, we'll move along. Anybody has any questions or any feedback? Okay, moving on to the next question.
I have a question about legislation. We voted up for you here. Please discuss any proposed county or state legislation which the county or the city is most interested in. How can GEAC help to promote or support the city? And with that, I say that since then, today, in the Greenbelt News Review, we had got a very good review that David Moran gave of six of those bills that the city's interested in. And now tonight, with the handout, we have another 15 or 20 of them. So we have an idea of the bills that the city is interested in. But there were 2,200, more than 2,200 bills, and a lot of them don't have anything to do with Greenbelt. But are there others, or is there anything you'd like to say about any of these in particular? I asked you about the dam money. I asked you about the request for monies to repair the dam. And that's still in the works, I guess, but we don't know what it will end up to be. Is there anything else that you'd like to say about that?
Well, the funding for the dam, Bunny Haddock Lake, Greenbelt Lake, there are some problems with the underpinning of the dam there, and we're under consent with the Department of Environment to make these repairs over the next 5 years. It's a very expensive process because of the where the dam is, the lake. It's sort of above the airport, it's actually above the beltway. That dam would have failed, the catastrophe. So we are actually looking for resources. We phased the project over 5 years. We've been looking at the capital budget and trying to figure out how we approach this. And we actually asked the delegations for a bond, a supporting bond in the range of $200,285. So the city intends this year to actually put about $250,000 of its own, $1,000 of its own.
To match
the outcome. And we're cautiously optimistic. There's a lot of uncertainty. We're not really clear how much money is available for us, but we make requests. One thing thing that was noteworthy in this legislative session is there were a lot of bills who were filed at the last minute. There were a lot of late filed bills. I think a record number of bills were actually submitted. But through our staff, David Brand, Mr. McLaughlin, also through Mayor Pro Tem Davis, who serves on the Maryland Municipal League Legislative Committee, other organizations such as the Prince George's County Municipal Association, I'm the president of that. We actually monitored the bills pretty closely and advocated for a number of them. David, Mr. Mario, is there anything you want to say on
that? Well, just Austin, you know, this is a comprehensive list of all the bills the city council has taken position on. As you mentioned, there are 2,000 to 3,000 bills every year. There is no way council can look at those at all. There's no way I can review all those bills. So these come to the city's attention in a variety of means. These are the ones that council believes are the most important to hear. In most cases, takes a position to support. In some cases, there's one on here that they oppose. So this is today the list of bills that the council has taken a position on. What you've got here is the bill, the council's position, and the status update on how it's doing. A number of these already are not likely to go anywhere this session because they haven't made it out of committee at this point. It's very late in the process. But I can be happy to provide anybody with specific information if they had specific questions. And you can go online to Jones and his website, actually download these bills.
Yeah.
There's tons of information available. It's actually a very good website with a lot of emails you
can today.
Yeah. Well, you can watch committee hearings, you can do all kinds of things.
So a lot of these bills are similar to bills that you supported in the past, because you know our state senator and delegates have supported them, like the plastic bag fees in Prince George's County, just finding a way to discourage people from using plastic bags. It's something that council has supported for quite some time. We have always, every year pretty much, we try to find ways to see if we can get more zoning and land use authorities more control over how things happen in Greenbelt. It never seems to get there, but we're continuing to fight for those things. An interesting bill, House Bill 376, has to do with electric companies and vegetation management. We really want to be in a position. We were able to negotiate with Pepco a lot last year, 2 years ago, when they came in with their energy reliability program and cut all the trees. We were able to kind of manage that. We would like to have more control over that. That's what House Bill 376 was about. The fracking bill, we support that. Ms. Pope or Ms. Matt or Ms. Davis?
That's supporting fracking. We are supporting the moratorium for further study. We're not supporting fracking.
That's right. That's right.
There are some other bills in the county council. I'm polystyrene, food containers, coal tar, so people want to clean up their driveway, they use coal tar. The county council is active in this too, trying to do some things, and I'm sure you're working with them. So.
In youth, all I found was extension to foreclosure, push it back 6 months.
That was a bill that Senator Muse put forward. I believe he actually targeted certain zip codes. Unfortunately, Greenbelt is not one of those zip codes, but I think the foreclosure problem is something that's been especially difficult in Prince George's County in some areas.
It's been a long time.
Austin mentioned the styrofoam and the coal tar. I gave those two bills to Mr. Moran, and at a city council meeting for us to support the code, but basically he probably would support. But just for the record, I asked our city manager, does the city use coal tar sealant? And we do not. And you should probably ask your contractors whether they use coal tar sealant, but maybe redo the roads or something like that, because they shouldn't. It's extremely dangerous. Styrofoam, the city decided a year or so ago to stop purchasing styrofoam. So that's, again, something also that you may want to look at in your own meetings. Paper cups, there's other things that you can use.
Thank you.
Plastic is
okay.
recycle.
Styrofoam, you can't have some of the foam.
It breaks up into little pieces down there, as a burst, basically.
Yeah.
And it's cancerous too, for you.
It's very dangerous.
Planning transportation, I think that, now, these questions that we're asking, we didn't specifically come up with these questions, or generally ask them. So we ask them this question with you, it's my question. Just so that you guys know off there. What is the current status of plan for revitalizing Buffalo Shopping Center and Greenbelt Mall?
Well, actually, I was just over at Double Lake Plaza, along with Mayor Pro Tem Davis, and we were talking with Capstan, the property agent for Double Lake Plaza. And, you know, as you know, we City Council, we really want to see a comprehensive approach, a comprehensive look at how things will happen there. There's so much anticipation with the question of whether or not the FBI will relocate in the city of Greenbelt. Frankly, I think it's having a somewhat of a cooling effect on some of the property owners. Everybody's sort of waiting to see what happens. So don't really have any updates on new developments at Beltway Plaza. They recently put forward a proposal to remodel the movie theater, the Academy Gate movie theater, and it was a pretty ambitious proposal. So we know about it. We don't really have any definite plans in place for the process that has to go forward with the county. They're looking for certain permits that they may not get. So I'm afraid I don't really have any great news about Double the Plaza. In general, the council has spent more time this year and over the past 2 years talking about economic development. We did actually contract with a consultant, the Sage Consulting Group,
Sage Policy Group,
to kind of look at some policy questions and make recommendations about strategies that we could put into place. Mr. Basu, the CEO, is an economist. He actually made some suggestions for tax credits. Some concerns about the age of our housing stock. We don't have so many new developments. So he put forward a couple of proposals for tax credits, residential and commercial. And he also talked about a number of other recommendations. There were five. So the city manager is actually looking at the possibility of doing something with the residential credits. We'll try to work out the details. In general, you know, I think that the city needs to kind of continue to invest in economic development strategies and actually kind of do some things. There's so much going on around us on Route 1 and Laurel and New Carrollton that we need to be very proactive and definitive about the direction we're going in, and because of the city manager, because of council, we're taking steps in that direction.
I agree. Anyone has any comments?
I agree.
All around us, there is economic development and growth. That's already been in the plans for years. And it seems that ours is kind of right in the middle. We're surrounded by this consumer hiking. You know, people just want to spend somewhere else. It's not much here that they want to bring back the fiscal money back here. Instead, it seems to be resolving around us from Billy to Laurel's now nice village kind of center there. College Park area, Hightsville. I think it's just New Carlton and Concert, kind of like the standing two areas that needs some development as far as economic growth.
Well, I do have to say we have a new restaurant in Greenbelt.
I know. It's the
question. Which just opened the doors. I was down there yesterday.
It must have been there.
But, yes. You know, I agree with
yes,
you.
Yes, I think we should think about it for a long
time. I have to tell you, I was happening. There's a new restaurant at Lamb Severn Road in Greenbelt Road that just opened up. It's a beautiful, huge, upscale restaurant called Sylvia's. Really impressive. So, yeah, we need to kind of, you know, figure out what the things that we want, and maybe they're not the same things that they want in rural College Park. Just kind of decide on those. So we have to actually work on them. Council's good at rolling up its sleeves and working. I know all the councils work on them.
Maybe the
NPI
does, and
then we'll
bring
on that. I think it will.
Yeah. I think that would be a game changer.
Yeah,
I think that would be a game changer. And I agree. And it is kind of like playing along with seeing what's going to happen. As for Belvin Plaza, the remodeling of the theater, which includes liquor license and restaurant and all this, I think somebody mentioned to me, I'm not sure, but somebody said there's an article today in the Gazette. So I haven't personally seen it, but something, because somebody came up and asked me, and apparently read it in the Gazette. So I said, well, I haven't seen it yet, I don't know what it's about. But we do have the new development also over on Greenbelt West Side, the Greenbelt Station, the new town homes. And I don't know if you have a chance, or if you had a chance yet to go actually over there and go up and look at one of the models. I mean, there are some beautiful homes. I was really impressed. they're really beautiful. I mean, it's very tight, but they're beautiful homes and nice quality inside. And it's a trip for us just to go and take a look.
They are beautiful. And some of them three stories by Ryan.
There's some.
It doesn't. Even if you go in, it doesn't seem as it's not like it just go up a little. It's kind of like level and walk steps, and you have a level and walk.
It's still a lot of steps.
It's a lot.
It is.
Yeah, a lot of senior community. Because I was thinking, I said, oh, this is really nice. I said, can I have the model? I buy the model, and she says, no, the model always sells first, which I always thought the model sells last. But my husband said, no, didn't you say you didn't want any more stairs? So I'm like, no. In this case, no. Too many stairs, but it's really beautiful. So if you have a chance, go take a look.
Yeah, things are going well over there. They're not just sitting there, they're selling fast. And there's going to be an apartment development going up. The developer came to City Council about 4 weeks ago and showed us the plans, and it's going to be a beautiful apartment, very upscale. So the south core of the Greenbelt Metro Station is moving ahead.
All right,
we'll
get the eye.
That's not
James C.
Yeah,
I'm
tired. All right, moving along to the next question. Judith, you're up next.
We had asked what updates the city has regarding plans for improving the lighting on Greenbelt Road between Hanover and Mandan, and the status for the Springcrest Drive light request, and you have answered one way. You have the update on your answering, which is there's no word from the State Highway Administration about Greenbelt Road, and you don't know about Springcrest Drive either.
Unfortunately, we don't really control the lighting on Greenbelt Road. We don't own the lights, street lights run by Pepco. So we made the request about the street light down on Springcrest.
That was mine.
And we're waiting to hear something back. I agree the lighting on Greenbelt Road is not suboptimal on Hanover Parkway. Particularly on Greenbelt Road, the way they kind of reconfigured the intersection, I'm really concerned about the crosswalk there at Hanover Parkway and Greenbelt Road. So lighting isn't very good. I think that turned pretty fast, pretty worried about it.
But it's Pepco, I think, is slow to respond. Several neighborhoods, because the Safe Routes to School over at Spring Hill Lake at Hanover School, they're putting all these beautiful medians, and don't you have these nice flashing lights so people actually pay attention and slow down, and they're still not working. We've been asking
six months,
and we can't get any answers. So it's very tough to work, get any response from Pepco, and make sure that they come out.
Right now, though, Pepco is working on this merger. And so it's very possible that everything is going to be on hold until the merger goes through. And then you have, is it Exelon or something like that?
Exelon.
And then a whole new entity.
So the second part of question, what about Greenbelt Road in general?
Was that the second one?
I think it was Mandan and Dan over there.
Okay.
It was on the previous page.
Oh, sorry.
Next page.
I would like to add, it's very dark across from Greenbelt Lake Village, especially where the bus stops. It's extremely dark. There's no lights anywhere near there.
Yeah, I appreciate that. One thing though, just about lighting and the streetscape in general on the Hanover Parkway, more so Greenbelt Road, we're really trying to figure out ways to do better planning, to work with State Highway and to work with Beltman Plaza and even to work with Berwyn Heights to kind of come up with a better plan before things move along too far with the FBI. Like to actually have sort of a board meeting vision of what Greenbelt Road is going to look like. So I'm hoping that we can actually get some sort of an update from State Highway. The 22nd delegation of State Highway, apparently there may be some funding available. One of the things that I want to work with on council is actually sit down with Berwyn Heights and Beltway Plaza and talk about Greenbelt Road, talk about the whole Greenbelt Road.
There is a plan, and it was done years ago, put on a shelf, but it was dusted off this year. It was put on a list of possible things.
Anyone else have any concerns, questions, or feedback?
No.
All right, we'll move on to the next question. Tom?
Number three, additional bus shelters are needed in Greenbelt East. What plans does the city have to increase the number of shelters?
Well, we have in our capital budget, the threshold, what we hope to do, what we actually plan on a more long-term basis is to construct 1 to 2 bus stops each year. Now, in the recent past, we've actually accelerated that, but we have funding usually in the budget for 2, maybe 3 bus stops each year. So we do have the new stop there in front of Honey Ridge, the traffic circle. And we've worked with the design of the bus stops to try and make them a little bit more protective for people who are standing out there in the rain. It's just kind of difficult to really put a stop there in front of the traffic circle. The circles are a little unusual. So if you can make and document a need for a bus stop, we would put it in the plan. We did accelerate the placement of the stop there at Honey Ridge ahead of the schedule. I'm very sensitive to this question. You know, I do take the bus myself sometimes, and I know it's like standing out too close to the street, or the buses and the cars are just skipping by. So we've been working to come up with a better design, but still something that sort of fits in with the ambiance that we like to have with our Greenbelt busing stops. Council, give some thoughts about that.
Yeah, each of those bus shelters, the new ones, cost about $5,000, and even though we build them ourselves. And we have to take into account that they're our whole city. So we try to find where the bus stop is that has perhaps the most people, or someone raises an issue and we get it there. As it says here, the next one is coming in at Hanover Parkway and River Drive. That one has been paid for by a developer. That was part of what we negotiated. They put the building up. We knew it was a medical building, so therefore we paid money for the bus shelter. So that was one way of getting some extra money. We did do a bus stop study. Our planning department went to each bus stop to see what improvements does it need. Does it need a concrete pavement so that you can stand in something other than mud? Is that a place where we could put a bench or a bus shelter? And so we're working on it, but it's a cost factor. Something new came up over in Greenbelt West. The WMATA put in all of the benches, putting benches in. that had advertised without our permission, and they were hanging over the sidewalk, they were inappropriate places. So to get rid of them, realize that people were using the benches, we are now going to put city benches there, so that's going to take some of the money to replace, so it's a work in progress.
Okay, anyone has any questions, comments, feedbacks?
No.
This is a good crowd. Moving along. Tom, you're next. Tom, I'm sorry, you're next. You're next. Missing the bus stop.
At what point, the next question was, at what point is the city informed about proposed, and I guess how are they informed about proposed county and state projects which affect the city, and how can GEAC have input to such plans and support the city's efforts to promote and influence such plans?
Thank you. With state and county road projects, transportation projects, those are big ticket capital items. So there's a very formal process for planning and funding of those kinds of projects. There's a whole process, regional process, that Mr. Roberts can actually tell you about a little bit. The Metropolitan Washington Council of Governments Transportation Planning Board actually has sort of a long-term forecast and a short-term constrained version of the long-term consolidated plan has all the possible plans that are out there. The constrained plan just has the ones that are funded. So there's a pretty structured process, but Greenbelt is very, very active in the Metropolitan Washington Council of Governments. So Mr. Roberts sits on the Transportation Planning Board, and Mr. Hurley is the alternate. So we actually are aware of the state projects that are in the queue. And Mr. Roberts speaks very vociferously.
Any state project that uses federal funding, or any project on a federal highway, has to go through the transportation planning board process. Environmental impacts, air quality impacts, and all that kind of stuff. And then it's approved in the transportation planning board. But you really don't have much, there really is not much room for input from the cities and individuals. So it's pretty insulated process unless you really have a lot of time to go to a lot of obscure meetings and stuff. Really hard to affect that process.
I'll tell you, we do our best to keep our finger on the pulse. So, I mean, if there's some, you know, if you have a comment or a thought or something that you'd like to see, we'll put it in the right place and speed up and try and move through it.
Well, we've sort of talked around this several times, and although there is a long-term planning process, that process is normally conducted by the professionals. What we're asking really is how can we have input to that development? And so if we have members, as Tom does, that say that, look, I'm using the bus and this is a dangerous situation, we need better information about how we can bring that forward so it can become part of the plan. We want to be part of the city. We want to cooperate on legislation and on projects to make the city better. That's what we're all about.
Right, right. Well, once again, there are these regional committees that sort of plan out a lot of our transportation projects. And with the buses, that's WMATA and the county. They're the ones that supply the bus service for the city of Greenbelt. City Council, we have work sessions, transportation work sessions, usually. For a while there, we're having them on a quarterly basis. More recently, we've been having them semi-annually. They're open to the public, and we publicize them on the website. Representative from the County Department of Public Works and Transportation is there. The regional planner from Lamont for buses is there. We citizens bring up issues all the time. We still have a bus coalition. it's called the Green...
True G.
Transit Riders United of Greenbelt. And they advocate really strongly for better bus service, particularly for Sunday bus service, better weekend bus service. So also with the bus stops, that's part of the planning process. If you follow the agenda, call me up, call the city council. We'll make sure that your concerns are heard. Believe me, we can bring them up.
Well, that again goes to me.
Yeah.
If you look at the work sessions and it's something that's a development that you're concerned about or subject of transportation, send someone from GEAC to go there because the people who go there get listened to. That's for sure. Whether we want to or not, we listen to them. That's something that speak a lot, maybe don't say that much, but we do
this. And if you have someone there who's formally speaking on behalf of GEAC, that carries on.
Mm-hmm. Okay. If I might follow up on that, on the transit thing, excuse me, as Mayor Jordan said, we're trying to get a work session scheduled, this round, if you will, of the 6 month meeting, and I think the date that I last saw, I think in an email just today, was either April 20th or 27th. But if you contact the city office, contact the city clerk, watch the news review, it'll show up there. The other thing to follow on the Transportation Planning Board at COG is, and this is more regular, it could be something that if you have this interest, roll into your schedule, because it happens, as it says in the notes, every fall, the state comes out with its consolidated transportation program, and that includes work that will be going on or being planned on, if it's scheduled, on Greenbelt Road, on Kenilworth Avenue, on the Capitol Beltway, on all the state highways in the region. And that happens pretty regularly. The council gets briefed on it, I want to say every September or so, and then there is a public meeting, and that, for many years, it was held over the state highway offices right on Kenilworth Avenue. More recently, it's been held down at Park and Planning on further down Kenilworth Avenue. So pretty convenient to Greenbelt. And if you've got interest just regionally or even statewide, it's a book about that thick. But for Greenbelt's purposes, it is Greenbelt Road, Kenilworth Avenue, the Beltway, those sorts of things. That'd be another way to get involved. And watch for the briefing of council, which happens generally in September.
We do want to follow up with Tom, going back to Tom's question regarding the bus shelter there. I drive by there every day multiple times, and it is a dangerous corner for residents standing in the bus. And I understand the circle is a problem, but if that can be shifted, and I know if that's shifted, there's no sidewalk, they have to create a sidewalk across more. But it is dangerous in that corner. It's not even my community.
I'm pretty sure our planning department is actually looking at the possibility of shifting and slightly. We've talked about it, we're looking at it. Our planning department, so they've got a lot of things on their plate. Our planning department has a lot of things on their plate.
Tom, you're next for the next question.
All right. The next question, I think, has basically been answered from the city. Governor Hogan has appointed a Department of Transportation has a gentleman who prefers road construction over mass transit, although a decision has not been made regarding what they're going to do. Does the city have any projects they would like to put forefront?
I think the Purple Line project is something that will have a pretty positive effect on Greenbelt. So as far as state transportation projects, Purple Line is something that we have advocated for through our four cities coalition. We meet on a quarterly basis and make decisions and policy with the city council of College Park, New Carrollton, and Mountain Heights. So we've sent letters of support for the Purple Line. I think it's going to have a big impact. There'll be a station in East-West Des Moines, Kenilworth, and there's another one back in the area between Whole Foods, where the Whole Foods is going to be, and River Road. So it's not going to come to Greenbelt directly, I think it's going to have a big impact. for me personally, and I think for a lot of Greenbelters, it's a choice between taking mass transit, Purple Line, and getting in a car and driving to Bethesda. I would really rather take the Purple Line rather than driving. It just doesn't make sense right now. Mr. Roberts, do you have any thoughts about this transportation question?
Well, I'm the anti-highway person in the city, I can say. I've been fighting highways for 20-some years at the Transportation Planning Board. And it's actually, it's starting to turn around a little bit because down in the district, they actually have a plan this year where they're going to shut down some roadways and turn them into bike lanes. So they're actually going to take away, you know, lane space for cars and make them for bikes. So I think that, in my opinion, the district is heading in the right direction because we can put in, you know, all the highways we want, but it's not going to cure the traffic problems we have. That's what we've been doing for 50 years. It doesn't work. So, you know, where I come from, if I do something once and it doesn't work, I look for a better way. The only way that I can see is driving in front of some of the cars and being more dependent on the mass transit. You know, like if you go over to Europe, they have a great train system and local, you know, transit and all that kind of stuff. We're just way behind when it comes to public transportation. So, but you have to you know, constantly be fighting the battle because easy way to go is just to build a new road.
I can tell you, locally, you know, Greenbelt, through our planning department, is really trying to work closely with the Anacostia Heritage Trails to, you know, kind of coordinate some bike trails and pedestrian paths and actually make those connections. So, of course, Mayor Pro Tem serves on the APA board, so this idea of bike and pedestrian tourism connecting up our downtowns so we're better connected with Berwyn Heights and College Park. It's, you know, there's a lot of activity. You want to say something about that?
There's a little bit of a trail that goes, the Anacostia Trail that goes past the Garden Show. There's a little section that has to be finished. And we just have to figure out who owns that little piece of the line that we can do. Something else I wanted to say, though, is that this is something that we need to look at. There's such a thing that is called a bike and pedestrian priority area, and I think maybe we should try to become that, because one of the bills going through the state is that the state highways administration has to work with a county or municipality that is designated a bike and pedestrian priority area, and they have to connect. So there will be some money there, perhaps. So I'm just suggesting that bill goes through, that we should look into that. Because we've been talking bike and pedestrian all the time. We're certainly in trails, we're certainly in bike lanes, so let's get some money.
Transportation is really one of the keys to our property values. And if you look at what's going on in the District of Columbia, some of the metro stations, you know, it's those communities that are connected that are really thriving right now. So having Sunday bus service or being able to get back and forth without a car would be really helpful. I just wish I could just park my car and not drive. And if I could, you know, go downtown and see a play or something and leave at 10 or 11 o'clock and be able to get back to Greenbelt by taking the bus, I probably would. But as it stands now, you can't go down to the Kennedy Center and to the opera and have a performance end at 10 o'clock and actually make it back in time to get the last bus from Greenbelt Metro.
The Metro runs without the bus.
And don't you need to compare D.C. essentially, because D.C. is more of a city, compact city, Greenbelt more of a rural family environment. It's a vast difference, but the bike and pedestrian is much, you know. If I work in D.C., I would want to come home to relax. Thanks for the comparison.
Mr. Roberts.
Yeah, I think there's one good thing about Governor Hogan's philosophy on transportation is that I think he is going to put a lot of money into actually fixing our existing roads and bridges and stuff like that. And that is something that really needs to be done, because we have a lot of problems with bridges. I mean, everybody sees all the potholes that we have right now. So, you know, the larger your transportation system gets, the more money you have to put into it every year. So at least he's gonna, I think, invest in, you know, what we have now. I think he's not gonna stray off into wanting to, you know, build more infrastructure, but I think mostly it's gonna go to existing infrastructure, so that is good in a way.
Next question, Austin.
And we have two questions here on emergency preparedness. In the event of an emergency evacuation, some residents in the Greenbelt East will not be able to get to a shelter in the Greenbelt Community Center. How will they be assisted? What is the status of updating the Greenbelt Emergency Operations Plan? And how are the needs of the disabled to be addressed during an emergency? The response that we received, the written response, is very complete. And in reading it, I don't see that we can add a whole lot to it. Pat McCoy, Pat, you've been very much involved with emergency preparedness. Maybe you have something more to say. But as far as I'm concerned, if we follow the response that you've provided, you've answered the question and we're in good shape. So.
I don't know, because, like, for example, if we have a famous blizzard, and in Greenbelt Lake Village itself, if we're basically, you know, immobilized, and hypothetically, we lose electricity and we have to, you know, go somewhere where it's warm, we can't get to the community center. Where do we go?
Everybody's probably gonna hate me for saying this, so, but I'll say it. If I lived in your community, if I lived in Greenspring 1 or Greenspring 2, there were an emergency, you know, evacuation, a really bad emergency. When that happens, that's really not, it's an emergency when the state or the county have to declare an emergency. We're sort of beyond responding to it. But personally, if I were living in Greenspring 1 or Greenspring 2, I would probably, recently, I'd probably get over there to Trinity Church or to the community center or the volunteer fire department on Good Luck Road, because those are really the closest public buildings. Trinity Church, of course, is in Greenbelt. Because, you know, it is a couple of miles. So everybody's looking at me like, but that is what I did. Personally, that is what I did.
The hospital, and like it's said in here that it's pretty likely that Roseville High School would be, then the Red Cross would come in, I would assume, you know, and come in and set up in a large facility. And Roosevelt has a very large cafeteria area, and I think that would be probably, that's really comparable to our community center, size-wise.
But I mean, really, you're closest to the hospital, is right there.
Right, the hospital is right there. They're always, you know, they have extra generators and et cetera on hand, yeah, so I think that's probably really safe. That would be a safe place.
And homeowner association and condominium association probably should sit down and have a committee or something to talk about that. Because the biggest problem is that people think that a disaster is never going to happen. Well, all it takes is a fire in your building or a bad windstorm, and all of a sudden you have an emergency. And electricity goes out. Remember, we had electricity out for 3 or 4 days, and all of a sudden, oh my God, what are we going to do? Everyone should have a plan. And I'm just as bad as anybody else. I'm going to make a plan, and you know, I've got a little bit of flashlight here and a little bit of this. But really, if your residents are that concerned about it, then you should have within the home association, and then we'll work through GEAC, and then the city's working on it. I have I belong to the Emergency Preparedness Council for the district and so on. And even the businesses now, they're telling businesses, if there's a disaster, shelter in place. You be prepared, whether it's in the basement or someplace to have a place for people to go, have a generator, have water supply. And so, because people think, there's a disaster, I've got to go home. Schools are going to shelter in place too. So we just have to kind of get into this idea that
the idea that we all get in our cars or that there's buses or the army's going to come and take us to a central place, that would be as if the whole town was wiped out. If it's just a section, there'll have to be something else. And something else that we need to do, and I know that our group is working on it, you have to have a plan for your companion animals. You talked about the disabled, that is a plan, companion animals. I know even the Red Cross is working on this because people won't leave if they can't take the dog or cat.
I really want to commend you on your forethought in bringing up this issue of public safety advisory. I mean, it's supposed to be actually updating the city's plan, so with my comment, I wasn't making a comment to say that the city is not going to respond. I was just saying, really survive it, and kind of look to the places that are closest to you. The city will respond. The city has a plan. The city is updating its plan. And, it's updating the plan, partially because of people like yourself that bring the subject up and insist that we can come up with solutions. So thank you for your service on the CERT, and thank you for bringing this issue up.
And GEAC can certainly assist residents and community if we need to step up and have a plan in place for residents if they're unable to or clarify what is the public safety plan for an emergency. As a matter of fact, I sat here and my phone was buzzing, my app went off. My employer has an emergency system in place and has been contacting me for the last 3 hours. I'm going to get more phone calls until they reach New York. I go to work and they're like, get some an email. And we're trying to make sure you're safe.
Yeah, and we do have a phone system in place where we can send out the police department. I don't know if you've been receiving them. Alerts from missing people. We have a phone system in capacity. Can you describe the system?
The city does have an emergency system called Greenbelt Alerts. And anyone can sign up for it. They can sign up to receive the most common emergencies that we're likely to experience here currently are weather related. That storm coming through, as you mentioned, blizzard, snowstorm, things of that nature. And these alerts you can sign up for to get weather alerts from the National Weather Service, so you can kind of be paying attention if you take appropriate precautions. But the city can also use that system to we have the capability now of, even for people who haven't signed up, it's a voluntary system, so it's up to people to opt in and say, I want to receive these weather alerts and these other alerts. But the city can actually invent a true emergency, and I'm talking catastrophic, big-time emergency. The city can actually hit every published phone number in the city with a recording to say, whatever it might be, whatever the advice might be. The advice could be shelter in place. The advice could be, Red Cross has set up a shelter in Roosevelt, go there if you need it. So we have that capability. We haven't ever had to use it. I hope we never have to use it, but those kinds of abilities we have.
Yeah, you can sign up on our website. It's on the homepage of the website.
You can just type in Greenbelt Alert or type in emergency alert and get to it.
Yeah, and you can make choices.
Okay.
What alert you want and whether you want them on email, you want by phone, and what you want. So it's a good system, yeah. One thing I would mention to all GEAC, I've been in another HOA where when they got into this, one of the first things they had to do was to identify where the companion animals and where the disabled people were in their community. Actually, in some of our communities, there's not enough interaction to know where the need is, but you have to first begin with that and then begin to satisfy it. So, yeah.
We're
going
to move on to crime.
Okay, the first question. There is a perception that police patrol resources are focused on the city historical area and Greenbelt West. Please outline the policies which control the allocation of those resources.
Okay. I feel like I've been talking a whole lot. Does one of the city council members would you like to respond to that?
Simply put, as it says in the narrative, the city is divided into sectors, three sectors, Greenbelt East, Greenbelt West, and Historic or Central Greenbelt. There's an officer assigned to each sector 24/7. depending on the staffing, there's at least one floater, if not two or three floaters available. And they will respond wherever the calls are, but there's always an officer assigned to the Greenbelt East sector. In addition, there's the Eleanor Roosevelt School Resource Officer. There's also slotted, if you will, in this section of town. So that's the policy that governs the allocation of officers.
Yeah. I can tell you that the Greenbelt Police Department has been a leader in some of the concepts that are associated with community policing. And in doing so, one tactic that they use, they have sort of a floating command squad where one of the lieutenants actually looks at real-time and historic data on where incidents and crimes are happening. And they create strategies, short-term strategies, like for the next week or for the next month, because we've seen someone incidents at an ATM machine where they actually put more officers in the vicinity at different times. They're actually a very good, pretty good ahead of the curve as far as using the data that they collect to create strategies to actually target and focus on areas. A couple of years back, they did put a lot of time and resources into trying to deal with some of the problems when there were a lot of problems at Franklin Park. I guess that was about 3 years ago. And by working really closely with the apartment management, with the folks over at Quantum, and I think that their strategy is actually helping quite a bit. And now that that's not so much of a problem, there is more of an emphasis and focus on Greenbelt East. And I know that there have been some incidents in Greenbelt East in the last year. Everybody is really, really sensitive. I think one thing that maybe is a little different now, something happens, everybody knows that because of social media. If you look at the statistics, if you look at the number of crimes or problems in the city of Greenbelt, Prince George's County, Washington, D.C., it's at historic all-time lows. And crime is down, crime is lower. Most crimes are lower than they've ever been. So part of that is because of the strategic approach that Chief Graves and Greenbelt Police use. Part of it's a general trend. But no crime is small. It happens to you, it happens to your neighbors. So appreciate it.
I'd like to say one further thing. We've had discussions in GEAC several times over the past year about the fact that the statistics that are presented aren't as useful as they could be. I understand from our meeting last month that the city may be broken into as many as 54 little areas that are identified, and so that you can look at statistics in those areas. But when we normally get a crime report of some kind, it includes Greenbelt East, including Greenway Center with all the residential areas. That's apples and oranges. There may be a whole lot more pickpockets, shoplifting, whatever going on in Greenway. I mean, but in the residential areas, we're really interested in what's happening in our area. And we still would like to see those statistics. That's all.
And I've been assured that we're about to come up with something to actually answer that.
So I actually got it from George Matthews. I called, and he was able to give it to me.
Right.
But it's not in the normal pattern. You have to ask for it specifically.
So I believe we're working on some an app to make it possible to do that. Because people, you want to know.
Sure.
It is Apple Store, what's going on. Trespassing in the Greenway Center does not have a lot to do with what's going on.
Right.
Let's see. Ms. Mack.
Okay. And it is true that crime is going down. But I think one of the reasons, and I've heard this, I think, from George Matthews, who we talked before, the senior citizens, one of the reasons is that criminals have found it's easier to you take your money online from scams and on the internet. So they don't, you don't see those, that physical crime, which is very, very disturbing. But now they can just pick your pocket without even seeing you. means that you really need to be very careful about, you know, what you're doing online and how you're doing it and how you're protecting your identity. And what you put in your trash and recycle, make sure you take your name and everything off, because they will go through there and...
Yes, and they will go in dumpsters.
Yes, yeah, they'll go in dumpsters, yes, but no, I try to take everything off, you know, I have a shredder at home, and I think everybody should really have a little shredder where you can shred the things. But as for crime going down, and I know that in Greenbelt East you have this big, if I want to say had, this issue with all these break-ins, and I know we say crime has gone down, I know you probably don't feel that way, and like, well, where has it gone down? Because we have keep having the same break-ins, and that is a big issue. I think that the police is now, after all the meetings, aware of it, and I think working on that situation, and I personally, because I drive over in the neighborhood all the time, I've seen them around more often, I have to say that. So hopefully that will deter, you know, but as you all know, it just kind of crimes moves, as you know, so we'll just have to be aware of all situations in your own neighborhoods. If you see something that's not right, you know, call. And for the detailed crime report in what area, people were talking about that at the last GEAC meeting, and I was under the impression that they're working on the system and to see how to be able to put it online so people actually can click on their area and your area will, or your neighborhood will come up and it gives you a detailed report about what happened in your specific neighborhood. So I don't know how far that has flourished, but maybe we can check it out.
They're working on a brief, we're shooting for a briefing for city council at their budget work session with the police department. If we do that well and that goes well, then we'll be ready to roll in something out this summer for the general public.
Jane?
We all laughed about the dumpster thing, but I actually have seen someone who was taking things out of the dumpster. I did report it to the police with a license plate, and a police officer actually went to this house, which was a Greenbelt resident. And he insisted that he wasn't, but I know he was. He was taking out bills. You know, you could see he was throwing back all the inserts, but he was grabbing anything that was a bill and putting it in his trunk. So anything, I mean, basically, in fact, I'll just give you the date of the next electronic recycling, and I don't know when the next shredding day is going to be, but that's always a good thing. Electronic recycling is April 25th. I don't know when the next shredding is going to be. How many of you have signed up to do a ride-along with the police department? That would be very interesting. There's a form, and I believe it's online, I'm not sure, or you can ask at the police department. There's a form that you can fill out. They do a little police check on it, because they don't want to drag around someone that's got a felony or something. But I did that, and I found it extremely interesting. You can choose the hours. I chose nighttime, but figured that was going to get the most action. And I rode along in the front seat with a police officer who was a floater. And he did float. We went all the way through Greenbelt East and over to the South Court, the new houses over there. Kind of started going, all of a sudden he got a call. And the siren was on. Oh dear, what do I do now? And ended up in phase three. And there was a domestic. And all of a sudden, like three or four cars. And he said, "Ma'am, you stay. You do not leave the car. I will come and get you." I said, "Okay." And probably I should have said, "Don't touch anything while you're there." But it was interesting to see how their patrol works. So really, if you have night free, and it doesn't have to be the whole night, it can be 2 or 3 hours, and just ride along, and you can ask those questions.
I have a question. I, of course, there's no policeman here to represent, but how many packages are being picked up after they're delivered, say, from Amazon and so on? I mean, that this is a big problem across the country.
Yeah.
I'm not sure. Does everybody report it to the police, or you just call Amazon or wherever you order from and say, "Hey, this is a delivery"?
Yeah, it is happening, especially on holidays, it is happening a lot. So yes, people do watch out and they, you know, see those trucks coming and they come and smash your goods. But I'm not sure if I'm reporting on that.
There'll be a theft, you know, because of the way our different homeowners associations are structured, a lot of us have small lot post office boxes, sometimes UPS will leave a box in front of the door. Greenbelt Lakes, I guess you have to have a key or access to get in, so that's UPS, can they get in?
They have their own code to get into our buildings.
Okay, and Green Spring 1, 2, single family home, so it's
on the porch.
So it's sort of a potpourri of how those kinds of deliveries are actually made. The thing is UPS, there's subcontracting those deliveries out. So we've got these companies that aren't UPS or FedEx that are making deliveries and postal services. It's a problem around the holidays.
I think the positive thing is when you have something in mail order, you can track it.
Yeah.
And a lot of times they tell you, you know, it has left Baltimore, it will be in your house in the next 3 hours or so, and then maybe you can ask the neighbor to look out for it, or maybe if you have a chance to come home, you know, for lunch, or have somebody else look out for it. So I would suggest that if you have something come and make sure you track it, so at least you have an idea when it's going to be there, so it's not like laying out there all day. Because in my townhouse, I have steps going up, and you know, if something's laying there, you can see it. And the other thing, some of the drivers, they think a little bit before they put it in front of the door, but they have a big flower pot in front of there, which sometimes you stick it behind a flower pot or a bush a little bit. So, but I would suggest tracking your items. That's probably
That's what I do. I just, when I have a package coming, I usually cut it off, and I just want to pick it up from the station myself, because that way, I don't know the time I'm going to be home, so someone waiting for something that's
very important.
I want to follow up with Mike McLaughlin regarding the section of it. I got this from the Greenbelt East Statistical Report. You mentioned it's breaking out into three sector. I have six sector. Greenbelt Center, Franklin Park Area, Greenbelt East, Belgrade Plaza, Metro Site, and Branch Valley Area. Just as of December 2014, Franklin Park had, well, the total number of crime reporters 803 in 2014 compared to 2013 was 928. 61, approximately 61 down. Franklin Park prices have been going down compared to Greenbelt East. Greenbelt East had 316 crimes reported as of December 31st, 2014. As opposed to Franklin Park, total year to date is 273. In 2013, Franklin Park year to date is 357. Greenbelt East was 291. So that went up quite a bit.
But look at the types of crime. We tend to be crimes of opportunity, where their crimes are more car theft and physical, or domestic. So it's like, again, it's not much like, I ask that question all the time.
Yeah, the majority was larceny, 229, Greenbelt East, Franklin Park, 117. So it seems like Franklin Park and Greenbelt East are kind of shoving side by side as the year progresses. It's only January, so we've got about 23 in January. I haven't got February is not on this. So it's still problematic that we're having crime activities in Greenbelt East.
If I might, the question we got, they break it down there for tracking purposes and following on the question, Mr. Henry's question, I'll go back to the department and talk about, can we segment out Greenbelt East commercial versus Greenbelt East residential? But that the question that you raised here is, what's patrol coverage? Patrol coverage is by the three large neighborhoods. But they've broken that down just for tracking purposes, largely because it's much better now. Years ago, the majority of 50% of crime was occurring in Greenbelt West, and they wanted to know how much was in Franklin Park, how much was in Beltway Plaza, and they also wanted to separate out the metro station because that's a particular, unique kind of crime that's going on generally over there.
This is more a comment followed up by a question. Surveys were sent out to victims of crime approximately a week after the crime, and some victims were surprised because they thought that they were going to receive the status of the crimes rather than just a survey. You mentioned in the answer why the surveys are sent out and that that's a requirement. But the question is, I think we've already talked about in part that they want to see, or people in Greenbelt East and everywhere, I guess, would like to see more statistics of crimes for their particular area, and we just discussed that. But also, in connection with that, did the department adopt a primary role of public relations, rather than police department? Adopt a primary role of public relations rather than public safety?
Well, I wouldn't say that. The police department, they are sensitive about trying to manage people's reaction, which is really passionate. Something happens to you, it's really, really bad. So as was the response that's here to your question about the follow-up has to do with the accreditation process that just actually went through the process again. The City of Greenbelt Police Department went through this Kalia assessment process just last week.
What's Kalia stand for?
Commission for the Accreditation of Law Enforcement Agencies.
Right. So it's sort of a comprehensive way of capturing all the practices, policies of the police department, just kind of tracking what happens here. So, Mr. McLaughlin, so this idea of sending out a survey a week afterwards, or just following up, how does the police department usually follow up after the crime report has been filed?
Without knowing the specifics of this particular incident or if there was or more than one, it appears what happened is two things crossed. One, there was an incident. And two, as part of their follow-up process, the department will randomly from time to time identify incidents that occurred and then send out the survey. And that's what it sounds like happened in this incident. Got randomly selected. This happened to be a week after. Clearly, the person that was impacted was still traumatized by it and thought that we were doing A when in fact we were doing B, and it was just the randomness of the situation. But at any time if somebody has a question about what would be the status of an incident they were involved in, they can certainly call the police department and ask for an update. If there's more to this story than that, I'd be happy to talk to you.
So that's what, when someone files a police report, the best thing is to follow up a week or so afterwards and actually call to find out what the status is.
Okay.
Okay, next question is Tony. There's a spike in crime surrounding online transactions such as with Craigslist, etc. Many cities provide a safe space to meet for conducting these type of transactions at their local police department. Would Greenbelt Police Department consider offering a safe place for residents to meet and facilitate such type of transactions?
And the response was, they are actually willing to look at that. There's a small office in the police station lobby which can be used for such purposes. So they're actually willing to look at trying it out. It's a good suggestion.
Because there was one recently, just I think within a week or this week, it was a Greenbelt Craigslist transaction regarding an automobile.
I think I saw So is that the metro station?
Metro station, yes. So that's good to know. How can a resident be aware of that?
This is, I didn't know this, so that was actually really interesting to read this today, that there is a so-called a safe space provided for these transfers. But something else happened last week, and it was kind of really, it was really cruel. I mean, really bad things. So Craigslist, I don't know why anybody would want to go on Craigslist, because everything I hear is just really, really scary.
But I agree.
It is. I mean, everything I hear is so much that I said, where did we, you know, what happened? And, well, they met on Craigslist or this and that. Mm-hmm. And last week, that experience was really, really cool incident. But, yeah, I think it's interesting. And I was going to suggest, too, somehow that we advertise that on our website or in the newsletter when it goes out or somehow, because I didn't know it. I'm sure there's plenty of other people who are not aware of it. And I think that is a really good and safe way to transact business if this is the type of thing you do.
If you're
going to
deal with
Craigslist. I think our citizens here in Greenbelt, they should know about this. Because I'm sure there's thousands of people out there who probably have Craigslist right now, and they don't know about this. And I think that this is very important information. So we have to see if we can get that.
Well, I want to say thank you for the suggestion, because it was this question that I think brought it up. What it's responding to is that there is a space that could be used for something like this. The department is looking into it. I expect they'll say, yeah, we can do this, and when that decision is made, then we'll start to work on it. But thank you for the suggestion.
Okay. The next question. The city utilizes security cameras in Roosevelt Center and other parts of Greenbelt. Can these cameras be installed in Greenbelt East? And this can be considered, are there suggested locations? And that would be my first question, because you can look at the commercial space and say, all right, maybe it'd be helpful. But in the residential areas, we've considered putting security cameras up within our development, just so we know who's coming in and who is in the development. But the cost is not something we want to pay for under our HOA. So anyway, that's the question.
So I understand that some or maybe one homeowners association has actually done this themselves. Yeah. You know, I think it's important to remember that the cameras aren't so good at preventing crimes as they are about actually providing evidence to solve something.
Right.
On the other end of that camera, someone, we don't really have enough people to have someone staring, looking at one screen.
Yeah.
If you've ever gone over to the police department, I recommend that you do this along with the Mayor Pro Tem's suggestion that you sign up for a ride along. Perhaps you can actually arrange a tour for GEAC of the police station so that they can actually see what the dispatcher station looks like.
I'm sure George would work it out.
Yeah, I think there's two big screens, and I think we have about six of them, and there are about seven or eight cameras on the screen. So you know, it's impossible for anyone to have. We don't have someone watching the cameras, although it would be nice if we do that. We don't. So cameras are helpful more so in solving crimes than they are preventing
predictors. If Mr. Peters were here, he would say that every time we meet the Greenway Shopping Center, we suggest that they put up security cameras. And they just smile and nod their heads that we don't need them. So it's an expense. They would have to maybe hire somebody to look at it. And but we do mention it to them. We can't force them to do it. And I don't think it's private property that we should put cameras there. The reason why we have cameras at Roosevelt Center is that the center is Greenbelt Park.
Mm-hmm. Well, I would suggest having a task force. I mean, your answer clearly says it can be considered. I mean, are there any suggested locations? That would be Greenbelt Road. I mean, example, Greenbelt Road, Hanover Parkway, Main, you know, these intersection areas where the hotspots are. Strongholds Park, by that circle there, could be a possibility. Like Franklin Park area is, I don't know if Franklin Park area has one already. But if we could have a task force to collaborate and come together where that I mean, criminals could be deterred from seeing the camera, who knows that the camera's there.
It does not deter them. Just watch those people when they go in front of CBS or anything else. I mean, they're brazen about it. They really don't care. Or they wear a mask or something like that.
Well,
I don't think it deters, but it is good for evidence.
You might, if you had a list of what you thought the places, you might write them down in a letter, and perhaps then the council, I think, would refer it to the public safety committee to look at.
Yeah, cool. You guys think, would this GEAC eliminate them? Could we discuss that further?
No.
Okay.
But you have to make sure you're aware of the Greenbelt Road, you know, state highway,
right.
So, you know.
So we'll put that on the parking right now for the further discussion. And zoning, Tom.
Okay, zoning, this is a question you kind of alluded to before. As we know, Greenbelt does not have control over its zoning. And what is being done? Are we working with our new council person, et cetera?
Yeah, so with control over land use decisions, zoning, we would like to have more control over it. We have an opportunity to review detailed site plans, which is sort of like the last step of development before it actually becomes real. We can comment with conceptual site plans. We would actually like to have more say in that process. We'd actually like to have a role in making the decision. So that's something that we advocate for individually, but we work collectively. We're working with the other municipalities throughout Prince George's County, through the Prince George's County Municipal Association, is what happens in the Greenbelt. You know, College Park and Bowie really want the same thing. In fact, Bowie probably wants a little bit more than what Greenbelt wants. You know, we are in a position where we have limited resources in terms of staffing, and we do have a community development and planning department, so we can, in fact, we do have the capacity to handle more responsibility. Some of our sister municipalities in smaller places like Brentwood or North Brentwood, they really don't have so much of an interest. So Maryland National Capital Park and Planning actually makes those decisions about through the district council and planning board. They make decisions about zoning and rezoning and figuring out exactly how the details of the plan might look. So I mean, it's something we fought for a long time. And most recently, we worked with one of our delegates, Geraldine Valentino Smith, who is a delegate from former Bowie City Council member, put forward a bill during this legislative session. And the city of Bowie separately put out a bill with under Senator Peters. They're slightly different. And we tried to work with the Prince George's County Municipal Association to kind of back that. Unfortunately, we weren't able to really come to a consensus with all of our sister municipalities. We in Greenbelt have the capacity to do more. Some of our other, where municipalities abut one another, like Hinesville, Rubio Park, College Park. If you follow some of the discussions that were going on with the Kayford's property, you know, Whole Foods, which is almost finished down there in University Park, you know, the municipalities all have different ideas about what should happen. University Park is very residential, and the development across the street, Riverdale Park, is really not going to benefit them financially. So, long story short, this increased zoning and planning authority is something that Greenbelt wants and is working for, but it's not going to happen this year. Park and Planning, Maryland National Capital Park and Planning, and Prince George's County, they're actually doing a rewrite of the zoning code. First time in about 30 years, forever. Yeah, and that's a big deal. So we're actually working with Park and Planning that they have a say in how that rewrite of the zoning code happens. And we have a work session coming up on that on, what was that?
Monday.
Monday. So if you're really interested, please come down. We're going to get a briefing on the zoning rewrite on Monday for Maryland National Capital Park and Planning. That will be 8 o'clock in the municipal building in Council Chambers.
In the answer, it says that legislation was introduced in the General Assembly, but this bill has been withdrawn. Do you have any details on who withdrew it and why? I mean, I'm just kind of interested.
Maker of the bill withdrew it because she was expecting the full support of the Prince George's County Municipal Association. And the Municipal Association, because it's got 27 municipalities, could not get a consensus that this was the right thing to do. So she withdrew it so that it wouldn't be defeated.
Yeah.
And we can come back later.
Yeah.
If I might follow up on the zoning code rewrite, one of the issues that Greenbelt has raised, the Greenbelt Council has raised, as well as the Bowie City Council and others, is, what will be the municipal role in this? And this is a much bigger issue. There's a lot more oomph behind it now than there was the last time or whenever the zoning code was written. So I expect the council, I know I am particularly interested in finding out how they're going to answer that question come Monday evening, because it has been prominently raised by Greenbelt, by Bowie, and by Close to Common Park. Right?
The question is, does the city code enforcement have regulations regarding permits needed for portable generators and electric vehicle charging stations? These, and in your answer you said no, provided they're not located in a public right-of-way or on a public street. And wearing my other hat as chairperson of the Architectural Control Committee of my community, this has been an issue of, would the homeowners be allowed to do this and that, including these two items, if they wanted. And I did look at the city code about the generators. And if you can't restrict them on that grounds, if the decibel rating is very high, then you can get them on the noise ordinance, can't you?
That's right. That's right. There's a noise ordinance that prohibits sound beyond a certain decibel level. With the electric charging stations, we recently something recently came up about that over in GHI, and a couple of property owners in GHI have an electric car and they wanted to install an electric charging station. And in this particular location, the charging station would have been put in, but at the public space. So, city street. So, GHI, the property owner, agreed to take responsibility for removing the charging station if they move. And we actually agreed to allow them to do that at GHI. So, I mean, it's a trend. People, we see more and more of these electric cars around. And we have to find ways to accommodate what the people need. And certainly, the impact electric cars, the environmental positive aspect of having them around, we do want to be able to accommodate them. But often, just because of the way our developments are situated, the parking lots are on private property. So really, there's no city regulations that forbid charging stations and generators.
This case in GHI, was this a movable station? Was it one that was affixed to the parking space or in the ground of the unit or on the wall? Or do you
know? I believe it was affixed to the parking space.
It's affixed in the ground directly adjacent to the parking space, which is just the way it happened to work out.
Mm-hmm.
The parking space assigned to the unit or the owners of that unit just happened to be next two green space, so I'm not quite sure if it had been, if you will, a middle parking space, how it would have been accommodated. But it's affixed to the ground, but there is an MOU between the residents, GHI, and the city, that said, should they ever leave, they're responsible for getting it removed unless there is a subsequent interest developer.
And the owner had to pay for the installation, activate the device, and would pay for it to be moved. And it's some of those devices you could actually take with you, so.
Probably would only have half a car.
I have seen charging stations in other municipalities, not in Maryland, but in other states, right along, you know, public.
Yeah, they've got a few of those in Maryland. There's one down at the very foot of 301 before you go across that bridge over in Virginia.
College Park's new parking lot garage has charging, Mom's has a charging space. There's more and more of them.
One more.
There's, so, more electric cars. Vehicles are probably more.
Moving on to the economic development. Economic development study recommended by proposal, what is the status of these proposals? And I think we highlighted.
Yeah, basically, the study focus groups, a lot of research on the information that's out there in our community and surrounding communities. There were five recommendations, and three of the recommendations are under active consideration. I think council is in sync in trying to create some incentives. One had to do with, just in general, is encouraging home ownership, and that's something the city council has advocated for a long time. So that's something we continue to do to promote owner-occupied housing by the city. Also, the development plaza that the city actually supported and worked with development plaza to try and make some positive changes. That's something focusing on. They took a look at Roosevelt Center and were very had some suggestions about the city trying to take more control over the occupancy in Roosevelt Center. As you know, we've got the movie theater that we've been renovating over there. The city actually owns the movie theater, which is a little unusual. And just to put a blatant plug in there, the movie theater is about to open again. Probably about 4 weeks from now, we're going to have a soft opening and a hard opening. And we actually selected a nonprofit organization to run the movie theater. So above and beyond just regular, the outstanding movies that will be there, we're looking for some additional programming for the family. Ms. Mack, do you want to talk about that?
Programming for festivals, themes, and also Friends of the Greenbelt Theater have been having discussions with the Curry Smith Center at the University of Maryland and with the theater department at the University of Maryland. So there's some opportunity for some educational programming in addition to first and second run movies that we're used to. Also, there's agreement that twice a month the theater will be made available to the city recreation programs, recreation department programs, so that as a free of charge. Also twice a month the theater will be available to community groups to do something free of charge, which I felt was just outstanding, that we are really going to have a theater that is part of the community, that understands being part of the community, and also can look broader at other ways to involve the film experience. It'll be exciting.
The study, the things that I thought were most interesting, the consultant, he had some suggestions. He was looking at our housing stock and also about the office space. We have a lot of office space that's vacant in Greenbelt. And at the same time, there's a lot of new office space that's being built in the Katerra development and over in College Park. A lot of new apartments going up, a lot of new offices. So what he suggested was sort of a couple of tax incentives that worked kind of like this. He suggested that on the commercial side, that if a property owner had a piece of property that was a million square feet, which sounds like a lot.
But they were going to invest $10 million in the building, which they thought would be cover maybe two floors of an office building or about space for 100 employees. Then their assessment, then their assessment would be frozen for a period of 6 years, and so they would reap the benefits, if you will, of greater property value, but frozen taxes. So they would reap that differential, if you will.
Right. He proposed this for both commercial and residential. So I thought it was kind of interesting. What does, you know, if a homeowner or a commercial property owner invests beyond a certain threshold in their property, then their assessment is actually frozen for a period of 6 years, which means the city doesn't really lose anything, it just stays the same. But they make the investment, and then the property is revitalized, then after 6 years, the assessment goes up. So it was really an interesting way of approaching this. I know the city manager and the treasurer were actually kind of looking to see whether or not we can actually do this. The thing that's creative, it doesn't mean that we don't lose any money from it, it just freezes the value. Then once the investment is made, after 6 years, it goes up. So it's not really a loss for the city that they'll offer this kind of incentive.
What percentage office space is vacant?
25%.
Which is higher than the county. The county.
Is that one of the three active considerations?
Just thinking that because we have this vacancy rate, if we don't do some things to improve, to upgrade the quality of the space, then we're going to be at a competitive disadvantage to the surrounding areas.
So you just mentioned that was part of that study group, and there was some very strong opinion. So his recommendation was pretty accurate according to the group that was in that study group at the time.
Yeah, thank you for participating.
Yeah.
We're trying to do some, trying to just build better relationships and improve our communication. So we're actually planning a business coffee on April 8th. We invited some business, the larger business owners to talk with us, have a coffee.
Okay, now FBI site, Austin.
Well, we can have a day on this. What will be the impact of the development at the Metro if FBI selects Greenbelt as a relocation site? That's the question, and I don't think we have the basic answer here yet. I think we have a lot of unanswered things, but there obviously is some prior planning. If they do come, they have to be accommodated somehow within the city structure. And if they don't come, where's the plan B?
We're searching for plan B.
Well, we're working on some ideas and trying to, these incentives that we're talking about are sort of getting at the existing problems. If the FBI does come, there'll be some impacts. But the site, Greenbelt, as far as from a regional perspective, want to have that consolidated FBI someplace that has the capacity to handle that many people, 11,000 people, because it's right at the Metro station, because the commitment is there to build out the exchange on the Beltway, it would have less of an impact on Greenbelt than the other sites would have on the county or the region. So, it's certainly a site that really makes sense.
Yeah.
From an environmental standpoint, got the Metro station as it is right now. It's a giant slab of impervious surface. So, and they're not designing Metro stations like that anymore. So by having a GSA facility come and locate there, that means that the building is going to be gold, LEED certified gold, which means that the stormwater runoff that goes in the Indian Creek, that's going to be mitigated greatly. It's going to make a huge difference as far as the amount of runoff that will go in the Indian Creek and will end up in the Anacostia and the Chesapeake Bay. Let's see, there's so many positive impacts. Now, in terms of our tax base, you know, those are federal jobs, so it's not the direct impact of having the employees there, but rather, since we have the office space, the contractors and the other service businesses that would come to Greenbelt, would benefit our tax base. I think it'll provide critical mass that will actually allow us to upgrade, improve our infrastructure, the transportation challenges that we have with Sunday and weekend service and more frequent metro service that would serve Greenbelt very, very well. So council is unified in support. Jay?
And unless you have, there were proposed designs, I don't know if you had a chance to see that, but right along the metro tracks, there is going to be a strip of commercial, retail, hotel, and apartment. So there is going to be property there that will be taxable as far as the city is concerned. And concerning the fact that you said, well, you know, why don't it look like, you know, College Park or High School or whatever, that section is going to be very dense. It's going to have restaurants, it's going to have a hotel, and it's going to be like a visitor center for FBI. It's going to be very compact right there. And so it'll draw a lot of the young people that we probably desperately need, because they love to live near where there's action, where there's transportation, and where they can get to other places real fast. So the South Core is going to be enhanced with that. It's going to probably do wonders for Franklin Park and I think Beverly Plaza at some point when they get their act together and come up with a whole plan, not just a little piecemeal plan. I know that Boone Heights is looking forward to doing College Park. The North College Park is not so sure yet, but when that house, the prices of the houses go up, they might be very happy.
And I'm comfortable with us being a resident of the property value.
Yeah, I think our property values will go up quite a bit. Because, you know, some of those employees who want to move here will be looking around the rules.
We won't know until what, 2016?
Yeah, the environmental impact statement is supposed to be out May or this summer, May, June 2015, and then the decision is expected a year after that.
And so even
just on the selection side.
That doesn't mean we'll have a whole FBI building all in 1 year. I mean, it's good. 2020,
right.
You may not be around.
Yeah, but your question, Austin, your concern is good. Well, we don't know that it's going to happen for sure. We don't know.
Right.
But it seems that our delegation, you know, even our governor, they are really, really pushing for site in Prince George's County. We don't see the site that really makes any sense, as far as I know.
Where is the site? Is the site at
the exactly.
And then all those other things are going to be the parking lot? The parking lot will be the FBI.
Right.
And then all these buildings. They're going to have garages and stuff like that.
Right.
And then the others right along where the metro station is.
Right. One of my concerns is that the actual metro station that does have the design of the actual metro station, the bus interchange is actually better than what we have now. So bottom line, they have the FBI over there, some new shops and everything, but if the metro station doesn't work to our benefit, then it's not so great.
And where are the 11,000 people and their spouses going to live? Here? If they choose to move here. Well, but I think it was like over half of the people live in Maryland.
That's right.
Okay.
40%
I think.
Yeah.
That's right. And, you know, most people who work down at the Reagan building now, they don't live necessarily here. They commute by metro.
I understand. I know that there's going to be more housing. We're going to try to accommodate some of these people.
Well, or people who have been holding off, like waiting to sell their units or whatever reason. All of a sudden, you're going to see a lot of
things. It's too early to talk about this.
Yeah.
Excellent question.
That concludes our meeting.
Very good. Thank you all very much.
Yes,
you. Very good.
Yeah. Thank you so much. Really, really appreciate having a chance to talk to you. And as the meeting wraps up, we're doing my...
I'd like to say 15 people, we actually had 20 people there, 19 people.
Hey, once again, though, thank you for your, buying us the coffee. We really enjoy our...